What is nature's energy source? And can we borrow some of nature's energy? In this video, I will tell you about the potential of bioenergy. The sun is not only usable as an energy source directly via PV panels or solar thermal energy generation. It can be secondarily used via biomass as well. All plants and trees on Earth use photosynthesis to convert solar energy into chemical energy in the form of carbohydrates. While doing this, carbon dioxide is converted into oxygen as well. This makes our planet livable for us humans and all other animals. Bioenergy exists in many forms. For ages, burning wood has been the dominant energy source and used as a heat source. Biomass-powered plants often use wood or agricultural residues to heat steam turbines and create electricity. Other crops like sugarcane and elephant grass are produced to make biofuels. A larger overview of these different types of energy sources will be discussed in the week dedicated to biomass in this course. My colleagues will introduce you to the various technologies to create biofuel. For now, we will stick to an estimation of the potential of biomass in the world energy mix. Currently, the largest biomass-fired power plant in the world is the Drax Power Station in the United Kingdom. It has a total installed capacity of 3,960 megawatt, of which 1,320 megawatt is powered using biomass. The power station uses all kinds of wood products that are imported from North America to produce approximately 8 terawatt hours per year or 22 gigawatt hours per day. Divided by the entire population of the United Kingdom of 64 million people, it comes to approximately 0.34 kilowatt hour per person per day or 0.12 human energy units. Similar to the other renewable energy sources, we calculate the production efficiency of this plant in terms of kilowatt hours per watt of installed capacity and the capacity factor. In this case, we divide the biomass production of 7.9 terawatt hours by the installed biocapacity of 1.32 gigawatts to get approximately 6 kilowatt hours per installed watt year. Dividing this by the hours in the year and multiplying by 1,000 gives us the capacity factor of 68%. It is interesting to note that this capacity factor of this biomass-fired plant is lower than the capacity factor of the hydroelectricity, but higher than that of wind energy. Now, let's make an estimation of the potential of electricity from biomass per square meter. As already mentioned, biomass takes its energy from solar irradiation. The yearly irradiation in North America is around 1,500 kilowatt hours per square meter per year, which is equal to 171 watt per square meters average over the day and night. Plants are unfortunately not as good as photovoltaic cells, and most of them have a photosynthetic efficiency between 0.1% up to 2%. The values for photosynthetic efficiencies can vary depending on the type of plant. Let's assume that wood has a photosynthetic efficiency of 0.4%. The average used power density by the trees is then 0.68 watts per square meter average over day and night. The wood is burned and the heat is used in a conventional steam turbine for electricity generation. If we consider that the thermal conversion efficiency is about 25%, this results in a final overall power density of 0.17 watts of electricity per square meter. The energy density of burning wood for electricity generation becomes then 1.5 kilowatt hours per square meters per year. Note that the overall conversion efficiency of solar radiation to electricity following this conversion route is 0.1%. Now, let's verify this with the actual numbers known from the Drax power station we introduced before. 4.6 million tons of sawdust and sawmill and forest residues are used for the biopowered capacity of the 1320 megawatts plant. If we assume that the entire tree would be used, it is estimated that they require a land area of about 8,000 square kilometers of forest on a continuous basis. So the power density per square meter is determined by the lifetime of a tree, which is determined by its moment the tree is chopped down inside its defined area. If we divide the installed capacity of the land requirement, we get an achieved power density of 0.16 watts per square meter. This is very close to the estimated power density before. Now let's consider biofuels. A similar power density estimation can be made for biofuels. In Brazil, there is a big industry of sugarcane for the production of bioethanol. Let's take the average power from the sunlight in Brazil, which is roughly 230 watts per square meters average over the day and night. Let's assume a very high photosynthetic efficiency of 1.5%. Unfortunately, not all carbohydrates can be used for the conversion to ethanol. Only the carbohydrate sucrose can be converted into ethanol. 30% of the chemical energy in the sugarcane is stored in sucrose. The conversion efficiency of sucrose to ethanol can be as high as 75%. Doing this simple math, we arrive at a final power density of 0.78 watts per square meters. The overall conversion efficiency from light to bioethanol now is 0.34%. I would like to emphasize that these numbers are based on very rough estimations. Nevertheless, these simple back of the envelope calculations give an indication on the order of conversion efficiencies and power densities that can be obtained using biomass. Later in this course, we have an entire week dedicated to biomass. Then we'll go into the depth on the technology and its potential. Another form of bioenergy, which is rapidly growing in some parts of the world, is biogas. Manure of livestock like cows and pigs is fermented to usable methane in big tanks like these. Just like carbon dioxide, methane is a greenhouse gas. The methane molecule has a global warming potential that is 72 times higher than carbon dioxide over a period of 20 years. Although the concentration of methane in the atmosphere is much lower than for carbon dioxide, it still contributes around 7 to 9% to the global warming. In the examples discussed so far, I have only discussed photosynthetic flora on land. Researchers all over the world are working on another source for biofuels, the photosynthetic algae. Algae can have a photosynthetic efficiencies that are multiple times higher than that of crops and can be grown in reactors as shown here. Bioenergy is maybe one of the most discussed sustainable energy sources around. We will quickly discuss the pros and cons. The main issue with crops that are grown purely for bioenergy is the so-called first generation of biomass is that they compete with food crops. As a result, the prices for food can go up because there's only limited agricultural land available. Using residues from agriculture and wood industry, the so-called second generation of biomass, or algae, the third generation of biomass, can both avoid this problem. A big advantage of biomass, of course, is that it can be stored. Ethanol can be used almost the same as gasoline in combustion engines in cars, planes, and other vehicles. The energy density in ethanol is a lot higher than, for example, electric batteries. However, the net energy gain of some of the biofuels can be very low. The energy balance of converting corn into liquids like palm oil and bioethanol can even become negative. This means that more energy is used in processing, transportation, land use, and fermentation than is finally stored in the biofuel. These aspects can affect the carbon footprint of bioenergy. The ideal situation, of course, is that bioenergy is carbon neutral if the amount of carbon dioxide that is released when combusted will also be stored in a plant when it is grown. But because the processing of a lot of sources of bioenergy is very energy intensive, and the carbon footprint is also very high in comparison with other renewable energy sources. The average carbon footprint of biomass, which is not co-fired with coal, is 230 grams of carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour. The carbon footprint of biofuels in a very wide range because of the big difference in sources and processes and can be as high as oil. Let's consider only the installed capacity of biopower for electricity generation. The global capacity is then 93 gigawatts. This is good for 433 terawatt hours per year, providing 1.9% of the total electricity market and 7.6% of the renewable one. This is equal to 0.15 kilowatt hours per day per person and is equal to 0.05 human units. However, the major part of bioenergy is not converted into electricity, but is used for heating purposes. The total installed thermal capacity on Earth is 305 gigawatts, producing a little bit more than 2,300 terawatt hours per year. If we now also include traditional biomass that is used for cooking, we get 12,500 terawatt hours. And including all the energy used for biofuels, it will make up 12% of the total energy consumption, which is 63% of all renewable energy. This makes 1.7 kilowatt hours for every person on the globe per day, which is 0.58 human units. To conclude, bioenergy is a sustainable energy that has a lot of benefits as well as it has downsides. I invite you to do some calculations on the potential in the world or in your country. See you in the next blog.